Welcome to the Biowulf Bash scripting class. In this section, we will walk through the process of logging in and out and explain how your environment is set up during this process. This video should hopefully answer the following questions. What happens when you log into Biowulf? What are the different shell types for Bash? How does your environment get set up and how does it change while working within Bash? As a prerequisite to explaining this, we must first connect to Biowulf using SSH. Hopefully, you already have a terminal application, such as Putty on Windows, Terminal on a Mac, Default System Console on Linux, or the graphical terminal client NX for No Machine that allows connecting to Biowulf using SSH. Keep in mind that you must already be on the NIH network to connect to Biowulf. If you are not on the NIH network, you will get a connection timeout error. For more details on connecting, go to https://hbc.nih.gov/docs/connect.html. I'm going to demonstrate launching Putty and connecting to Biowulf. I've already configured Putty and created a shortcut to the session. I'll double-click on the icon, and it starts up the terminal session using SSH. I need to give my username, and it displays the standard government warning banner. After entering the password, I've logged in. So what happened? After connecting with SSH, the kernel starts an SSH session on your behalf. It then starts a bash shell and begins reading through and sourcing the startup files. These include etc profile, all files in etcprofile.d, and three files in your home directory, .bashprofile, .bashlogin, and .profile. Once all files available have been sourced, your prompt appears and you are ready to start your session in the interactive login shell. Be aware that any errors encountered during sourcing of these files may prohibit the session initialization. You should know what you are doing when you edit the startup files in your home directory. Before going any further, I need to go in a little more detail about sourcing files. The source command takes, as its only argument, a file, and it executes the contents of that file as a bash script in the current shell. This is different from normal file or command execution, which runs in its own subshell. Because source causes the file to run in the current shell, it can be used to set variables and configure the environment of your current shell. The startup file can itself contain source commands. This is termed nested sourcing. There is a legacy command from the born shell called dot that can substitute for source. Dot is often used interchangeably with source. On Biowulf, users by default only have one of three personal files, /.bashprofile. And it looks like this. The first stanza of the startup file looks for /.bashrc, and if it founds, it sources it using nested sourcing. It then adds two directories to your path variable and exports it to the environment. If you were to install programs or create your own scripts, you could locate them in /.local/bin or /bin, and your path would automatically find them. As a tip, any line that begins with a hashtag is considered a comment and is ignored by bash. More about .bashrc in a moment. Once you've logged in and your shell is in the interactive login shell, if you type the bash command, you will start up a subshell. This subshell is termed a non-login interactive shell. Logically, because it is not the login shell, and it is still interactive. Subshells inherit the environment from their parent shell. Additionally, all non-login interactive shells source /.bashrc. Each time a new non-login interactive bash shell is started, .bashrc is sourced. Once the environment is inherited, and .bashrc is sourced, we find ourselves in the non-login interactive shell. If you recall, the default .bash profile startup file sources .bashrc. This means on Biowulf, .bashrc is sourced inside every shell. Let's have a look at .bashrc. On Biowulf, the default .bashrc sources the global file etsy-bashrc. This is a customization for Biowulf and is necessary to add all the module functions to your environment. There is a section below this to add personal aliases and functions. By default, it's empty. Aliases and functions will be covered in a future video. Either a login or a non-login interactive shell, executing any other command other than bash will invoke what's termed a non-interactive shell. By default, no startup files are sourced when initiating a non-interactive shell. However, if the environment variable bash underscore env is set, and if its value is a readable file, then bash will attempt to source that file stored in bash underscore env during the initialization of the non-interactive shell. The process instantiated by the executable would then run in the subshell with its own environment. Once the process is done, control is given back to the user session from which we started. We are still in the non-login interactive shell. If we type exit, this kicks us back to the login shell. If we type exit again, then we initiate the exit procedure. If the file /.bash/logout exists, the shell will source that file prior to exiting. It is actually pretty rare to need such a file, but in cases where you are running background processes or graphical programs, you could use /.bash/logout to safely stop them. Once that file is sourced and all processes are accounted for, the kernel ends our bash shell and logs us out of the system. In summary, SSH is required to connect from within the NIH network and start up a bash shell. Logging in, changing shells, and logging out triggers a series of source commands of several specific files. Some of those files are hard-coded to bash and are global for all users, and some of them are user-specific and under user control. Thanks for watching, and if you have any questions or comments, please email us at staff@hpc.nih.gov.